you know, the tree biology thing is a lot to get across in a short talk. So, some pictures to get your blood going, okay? I like climbing. The arboreal gene is a real thing. So this picture, that is Coast Redwood in Humboldt State Park. This is Philip Van Wassenaar, who's been here and spoken at this conference, and Lothar Guck, the inventor of the Picus tomograph, and that's Ma. And we are at the first branch in this tree at 165 feet, 50 meters to the first branch. And as you can see, the tree is still about 3 meters thick. Okay, the top of the tree, 342 feet, 104 meters. Okay, it's a gargantuan tree. So here's another one. And we have some friends here from Cortez Island who know this tree, who know this mushroom. And I first saw that mushroom in 1973 when, as a young man, I went up there exploring from college in my friend's VW bus. And I was into trees then too. And there was a little mushroom in the tree. That's Fomatopsis officinalis, the agaricon, the ancient medicinal mushroom. This particular mushroom, at least 70 years old. So I'm going to talk a bit about the basics of tree biology. We're going to do the characteristics of trees, a little bit about photosynthesis, a little about the tree's vascular system. The vascular system of the tree is the life of the tree. That's how the tree brings water and assimilates from the ground, and that's where the products of photosynthesis make their way back down the tree. So that vascular system lies right behind the bark of the tree. We're going to talk about tree associates. Trees are, we see a tree and we say, hey, that's a Douglas fir. But that Douglas fir is actually a huge group of organisms. It's not existing on its own by itself. It relies on interrelationships with many other organisms, particularly fungi and insects, and many things we don't even know about. So lichens, epiphytes, all those things growing on the trees, until recently, most scientists figured there was no connection to the tree itself, but with the modern science, we're seeing deeper and deeper into the world, the natural world, and it's very likely that new connections will be discovered. We're going to talk about the roots and soil ecosystem, and especially fungi, because it's pretty clear that every plant in the whole forest, every understory tree, every forb, they're all connected. They're all connected by the mycelial web, by the web of fungi in the soil. So if you go up in the forest here and stand on the soil underneath your feet, one footprint, you'll have a couple of miles of the hyphae, the mycelial hyphae, under that 2 inches of soil under your footprint. So they're everywhere. Trees are plants that are perennial. They live for a long time. They're woody. They have tough cell walls of wood. They're compartmented. They are made up of many compartments. And this is true of, you know, everything made of cells, really. But in trees, the compartments are tough and woody. They act as structure and they act as vessels for transport. They're tall, massive, and long-lived. They're woody and perennial. They're super survivors. There's trees up on the hill here that are from the stump of a tree that burned a couple hundred years ago. It's the same tree, a phoenix tree. But they're much more long-lived and much tougher than we think. But they're also, in a way, fragile. And some of the things we humans do can really mess with trees at a big time. They can adjust to changing conditions, but not rapidly. Trees take years to reorganize their structure when there's a major change in the environment that surrounds them. The most important thing about trees do not heal. Everybody know that? They don't heal. They simply seal. They grow a new tree over the old tree every year. They use huge amounts of energy, trees do. They're said to trap more energy than any other group of organisms on the planet. There's some discussion about the ocean, but it's a pretty good guess that they're trapping gigantic amounts of energy. They're very efficient, trees. They don't waste things. They pass on energy to many associates. So you'll see a dead tree sticking up through the forest. That tree has more living cells in it than a tree of similar size that's alive, covered with green needles growing right next to it. Think about that. That log is the second half of the life of the giant tree in a forest. All that stored energy is now supporting many, many other organisms. I mean, myriads of them. So more cells in the dead stalk of wood. How is that possible? They're generating systems. They make new cells in new places in the tree. That's the woody framework of the tree. So unlike animals that are constantly replacing the dead cells, remember, healing? They're not. They incorporate the dead cells into the framework. So the large part of the xylem, the wood of the tree, is essentially dead. Nothing biological is occurring there with the creation of anything new life, but there's a lot of energy there. And so the tree just keeps those cells as part of the framework. They regulate their growth based on the environment. Trees are using what they can, and they're very good at adapting. A common misconception for people who live in cities, especially those who consort with landscape architects, is that trees should be on their own. Well, I'd ask you again to look up at the forest. Almost all trees, with a few exceptions, trees in savannas or deserts, almost all of them grow in massive cohorts, forests. They're always crowded. They've always got many different associate trees growing with them. They're connected with each other and with many communities, and remember that connection about the fungi, because the way science is going, I'm pretty positive that the fungi are going to be very, very interested to humans for a lot of reasons. So let's look at a big tree. Get your juices going. How old do you think that tree is? I'll tell you, it's 11 feet diameter at the base. Would you believe 106 years? That's pretty interesting. 111 inches, that's at breast height or standard height where we measure trees, 4.5 feet above average grade. So trees are the tallest, most massive, longest lived organisms ever to grow. They can't move away from destructive agents. They can't run away from people. If they could, we would never see a tree because they would run for the hills whenever we got close. So if you're building in tree houses, you really have to understand your trees. If you're building anything around trees, I think you can add value to your project if you really know your trees. You know how they operate from a scientific basis. You don't exaggerate or tell small fibs, such as, I'm not going to hurt your tree when I build a tree house in it. Don't tell that fib. It's not true. You're always going to have an impact. It's unavoidable. So here's Ken Huck. Jason Lindsay, who's here, asked him about inspecting the zip line up in Talkeetna, Alaska. When we looked at the tree, we noticed these basidiomycete fruiting bodies. Those are mushrooms, okay? The tree, as Ken's showing with the tomograph here, this is a device that uses sound to measure the inside of the tree for hollowness or defect. That tree has only 1 inch of wood, you know? And the treehouse zip line guys drilled right into there and built their zip line in there. So I could go on a long digression about what we did and how we figured it out, but it's all based on understanding the species of trees and what's happening. We're testing a tree of the same species because now, by this time, I understand what that fungi growing on the trunk does to the tree and how it might affect the failure of the tree. And I'm testing at the base of the tree because while we're in the forest, there were trees falling over. They were falling over from another fungal problem that was located in the roots, and I was able to figure out that with my machine, I could find that. The classic plant pathologist will say the fungus is a pathogen. And I will say, as an ecosystem-based person, that the fungus is a commensurate organism or a symbiote of the tree, or even think of it as part of the tree. However, if you see a mushroom on the trunk of a tree and you know what kind it is, it's usually using up some of the tree's stored energy, so it's using up wood. So those conchs, those are mushrooms, spore fruiting bodies that you see on the tree. If it come up in the woods, I'll show you some, and you know what that causes to the tree. It's usually decay. Okay, decay is always fungi. So trees move stuff around. Now we're talking biology. We're talking the vascular system of the trees. So it's pretty important to know about this because people can easily interrupt this process. Hole in the tree equals hole in the system. There's really no way around it. Trees are highly adaptable, so if you think about it, they're really good at dealing with wounds. And what are wounds in a tree but holes? So I'll tell you for sure, trees are much better at dealing with holes than they are at dealing with something wrapped around them. Now a little talk with the help of Stoopsy. And this is the work of Klaus Matic. I'm one of two people on the planet that he lets use his stuff in talks. And you can see the sap is flowing down in the phloem. The phloem is the layer right behind the bark where new bark cells are created. So the cambium is not one thing. It's a series of layers at the edge of the tree. There are meristem, a growing point in the tree. The meristematic points in plants are where new cells are created. So right behind the bark, everywhere on the tree, all the way out to the twigs, is a layer of meristem cells that are creating bark on the outside and tree on the inside, wood on the inside. So in the upward realm, and this differs with species because some species things are going up and down in the phloem, but more generally speaking, inwards in the tree is the major upward flow of water and assimilates from the soil. And remember that that process is not possible without the fungi and bacteria. They provide the first link between the root and what's in the soil and get the whole thing going. So they're really only alive at the surface. The vital sap flows down, you know, and the vital water flows up, okay? So the cambium is forming new phloem on the outer side and new annual rings of wood, or xylem, as we call it, on the inside. So here it is, a little exploded drawing, and you can see that there's, you know, these are very simplified, but these layers of recent wood in many trees are referred to as sapwood because although they're not exactly alive, they're still conducting fluids up and down the tree, okay? When you go further in, the heartwood, that stops. There's no conductivity, there's no movement. The only thing the heartwood is doing is a placeholder, stiffness, strength, and stored energy. So here's the sap movement. It's two mechanical things that happen. The one is root pressure, which is called guttation. So this is a situation in some trees when the temperatures and humidities are right, where the pressure from the root can actually force water out of the stoma in the leaf, okay? So there is pressure developed by the root system, capillarity, okay? But the major driving force that pulls things up the tree, up the trunk of the tree, is transpiration. It's when the cells and the leaves let go of water vapor, there is a negative pressure generated. This is very strong. You'll see the pressures in millipascals. Big mystery with scientists, how in the world does a 300-foot tall tree move water and assimilates all the way to the top? It turns out that this is one of the ways, but that many tree species have evolved other little motors that they can use or adaptions like the coast redwood, which has a totally different foliage at the top of the tree where when the sun comes out it's a desert than it has in the lower portion of the tree. But we also now know that redwoods probably are storing water in the structure of the tree above ground. So let's talk about tree roots a little bit. The common misconception about trees is that the roots are going way down in the soil. And you can see that there are situations where that is the case. Sandy, deep soils with pinus species. Desert trees in Australia. So sinkers and jarrah. But in general, the shallow-rooted trees dominate. Okay, and in general, all tree root depth is based on what the soil conditions are like. There are a couple of different things that the roots do. They anchor the tree, right? But those anchoring roots are also the transport hubs for everything that's coming in from the smaller roots that they serve. So they transport free water and the substances that are dissolved in it. Those are the assimilates, minerals, etc., from the soil being brought up into the tree. They store energy and they hold water. So the root systems of trees are tremendous storage banks for energy in the form of sugar and starch. And this is not atypical. That's a road cut and some pretty good soils, but you can see down here, and this is fooling us because these roots have kind of drooped off, but as you go down in the layers of soil, you reach a point where there's no free air and no free water. And at that point, there will be no roots. Adaptation of roots. That tree is growing on an old log. So that in the Northwest, we'd call that a nurse log. And what's happened is that the tree has used that wonderful soil that came from another tree, the rotting, fungally decomposed soil. The fine roots of trees, they're myriad. They're very much in the upper horizon of soil. If you go in the forest here, and just easily with your hands dig up the leaf litter, the duff, you'll find tiny tree roots up in the soil where the leaves still look like leaves, where the decomposition process has just begun, okay? So these fine roots are the lifeblood of the tree. That is really the thing that keeps it going. Thus, it's common for humans to forget about this and say, Scott, I built the house. I didn't cut any big roots. But they have removed the top foot of soil or changed it, and they've removed most of the fine root system. These are not feeder roots. They're the fine roots, okay? They're very interesting. They have the ability to put material back into the soil, exudates. All plants have this ability. We know a lot about the exudates of corn, but we don't know much about the exudates of most tree species. Most trees above ground have how many sets of leaves a year? Generally one, right? Below ground, the trees that have been studied have between 12 and a couple dozen iterations of grow shed process in the fine roots. This means that trees are producing organic material underneath pavement when they grow underneath pavement. Okay? This is stuff that people don't think about. The fine root systems of most trees are dominant in the top 30 centimeters, or about a foot. Okay? They're dominant at that layer. The different soil characteristics, you might find fine roots much deeper, but in general, especially in forests, right near the surface. So you can take a rototiller, and if you do this at the wrong time of year, you can basically kill certain species of trees just by 6 inches of rototilling. You didn't even nick any large roots. Roots grow early in the growing season. Did you know that photosynthesis ceases at about 95 degrees? So during the summer months, most trees are relatively dormant. But then, particularly with temperate trees, as the leaves subsist, as they fall off in fall, there is a huge flush of root growth in the fall. This is the tree filling the bank account, filling the roots with energy for the next growing season. When you're in an old forest like this, some of these small plants on the forest floor are very old. This is true in your yard as well. So if you've got a nice Oregon grape or Mahonia or any good fern or any native plant that you like, think about it before you just trample that. Girdling roots, especially in planted environments, but also in nature, you will find trees that grow a root around the trunk of the tree. Tree roots will graft to tree roots, and tree trunks will graft to tree trunks. But in most species, the roots will not graft to the trunk wood. They're really different organs, just like the branch is a different organ from the trunk. The roots are a different, you know, part of the tree. So stem girdling roots like this can strangle your tree, or is something you should be looking for. And there's the visual tree assessment can allow you to see these, because once they're really doing this, growth is going to stop on this side of the tree. Here's another girdling root, a tree that grew planted by the Olmsted crew on a Park Boulevard in Seattle. That would have been the 20s. This tree failed from a girdling root. The tree, literally, you saw it. It was still surviving on fine roots, but it basically had pinched itself off. You know, some of you are from the mountainous areas in the West where fires are a problem, and the cities are making you clean up all the needles from your pine trees. Well, the trees aren't going to like that. The best mulch for every tree anywhere in the world is what?
Own leaves.
What falls off it? That is the best mulch. So the differences in the parts of the tree, this is the microanatomy of the tree, the anatomy of wood. Wherever you see green, what is that? What's happened there to make that?
Photosynthesis.
Does it surprise you to find that the tree is photosynthesizing in the bark? Most trees photosynthesize through the bark, so they get a little leg up in winter. Trees like Arbutus menziesii, the Pacific madrone, scratch your finger on one of the trees, just real gently on the smooth part, and green it is. That tree is photosynthesizing through the bark, very important to it. So the vessels in the wood, much smaller, not a lot of starch stored in the wood of the tree, but in the roots, the vessels are very large for storage of liquids and lots of starch. The starch is the dark color here, the staining from iodine solution. So the fungi, the mycorrhizal fungi are essential to trees. These Douglas firs couldn't do it without these guys. Many good edibles happen to be mycorrhizals, okay, like chanterelle. There are endo and ecto. So the ecto is this. Fungus is on the outside of the root, and the endo, the fungus is on the inside of the root. Okay, so these mycorrhizal fungi are pretty amazing under a microscope, and those hyphae connect things, and they also make that bridge to the soil. When you have good soils, these fungi will be there. You know, did you know you can go get some inoculum just by going and getting some healthy duff soil from a tree of the similar species or of the ecosystem that you're working in? Bring that to your disturbed soils and mix that in. That is inoculum. And again, if the soil is doing okay, it will come alive. The discoveries we're making now are that many fungi are endo in the tree all the time. So some of the fungi that become a decay organism later in the life of the tree are there even when it's a seedling. All the way along, what are they doing? Nobody knows. But at some point, the tree changes, the system changes, environment changes, something changes, and the fungi takes on its next step. It becomes an eater of wood or a decomposer of leaves. So if you can find big leaf maple in your area, if you look, their leaves are spotty. You know, they're like funny, interesting things growing on the leaves before they even fall to the ground. Those are endophytic fungi that live in the leaf. We don't really know how they get there, but they're in there for the whole summer as the leaf emerges, as it grows, as it does its job. And at the end of summer, as the hormonal changes in the tree begin to shed the leaves, those fungi turn on. They begin the decomposition process. They're in a good position high up to sporulate and disperse for next year, but they're there. Okay, tree roots. Tulip poplar. Anybody have this tree in their neck of the woods? Yeah. Sometimes called tulip tree. It's actually not a tulip and not a poplar, is it? It's liriodendron, tulipifera. This excavation was made with an air excavator, and you can see the worker in there. And about this distance down, there's no more roots, but there's going to be big pipes put in under there for conduit, for telecommunications and all kinds of stuff. But this surprises people, how shallow the root system is. These trees have roots across the street and in the rear yard of the houses across the street, and there is no need for speed bumps in that neighborhood. I mean, in fact, you know, high clearance vehicle, more like it. Those trees had roots when I went looking in the middle of a school play field covered in blacktop that was a block wide. So the tree roots from the liriodendron were more than twice the height radius. The tree roots from that Douglas fir right there could easily be found height radius from the tree. Everybody get that? So didn't you think that all the tree roots ended at the drip line, like they tell you at the county when you're trying to save a tree? No, they do not. Everybody know the term dendritic pattern? The fractal from, well, river drainage, it's a dendritic pattern. So from fat to finer to finer and finer and finer spreading out. So that's what root systems are. That's why people think I'm not going to do any harm when I dig these new roadies in under my tree, but every time they dig a hole, only this big, they're cutting off a huge area of the root network. Here is an urban setting. There are very few places in North America where it's unaltered. Every place you go, humans have been there dinking around. They built roads, they logged the whole place. Don't think you're in the wilderness. It's a very citified thing to say, oh, I'm in the wilderness now, and you're standing in the middle of a clear cut that was made 100 years ago. You think you're in the wilderness, you're in the woods for sure, but humans have altered everything. So here's a place where, you know, you look back in time as a forensic arborist, what I do a lot of, it's like, okay, how the heck did that tree hold itself up in only that much soil? And why weren't there any roots under the street? Well, that's not the original street. When Olmsted's crew planted this tree in the 20s, it was a very simple road, probably might even been a dirt road at that time. So over the years, the road was improved. They removed any possibility of root zone. In Seattle, it's rare to find a tree root deeper than a meter, or about 3 feet. So there's the tree, looking at it from the other way, like a cookie cutter. But the tree had adapted. If you look, you can see the roots of the tree. Do you see them down there, the fingers down here? Why are they shaped like that? You know, why aren't they going down deep into the ground? No good soil, no place to go. So just looking at this tree as it grew, a good visual tree assessor would notice there are no buttress roots on the street side. And then you wouldn't even have to dig. You know there's no root zone under that street profile. Okay, an old street could easily have roots under it. On this side, the tree was spreading out. There is no place to go down, so this root system is at most 18 inches deep. Why are the tree parts bigger there? They're bigger there because of the response growth of the tree. Think of those as anchor cables. And when force is applied on the anchor cables, when the wind hits the tree, those are where the force flow is transferred to the ground, and that's where the tree is going to add more material and grow bigger. So the mushroom, this rock, that's a two-man rock. And I wouldn't try with my body, I wouldn't try to pick that up with two men. We'd be rolling it. So I was camped here hunting mushrooms, of all things, up in near Cle Elum, on the Cle Elum River Gorge. And overnight, those mushrooms picked that boulder up out of the ground. Okay, that's probably a 120-pound rock there. All right, so the mushrooms are powerful. They could save the world. This guy here, Brian, we'll just say, Brian, I love to dislike you, but one of my arborist colleagues, but he's got his hand on a fungus. But look at that stump that it's coming out of. That stump has probably been in the ocean for a decade or more. Look how rounded it is. That thing has been crashing in the surf. This is claylock on the Washington coast. But that mushroom was still there in the tree, probably. I don't think spores came and landed on the tree. I think that mushroom is emerging from the wood of the tree where it sat for all those years until the conditions became right. And holy mackerel, what about all the salt? Have you ever burned driftwood like this? You know, burns pretty interesting because it's completely saturated with salts and different chemicals from the immersion in ocean water. But that mushroom's still there. And this, again, is, remember the mushroom at the beginning of the show. That's my boot. I'm up there in the tree taking a tissue sample for a DNA bank. And these mushrooms, Paul has discovered that they are as individual as you and me. So Paul is very interested in the medicinal aspects of this fungus, which has been used medicinally for thousands of years. Now thought to be extinct in Asia, likely to be extinct in Europe, although there are some very interesting forest remnants in Europe where we might still find it, but still known to exist in the Pacific Northwest in the old growth forest. One of the reasons we should certainly not be cutting any more old growth anywhere in the West, BC, Washington, Oregon. Shame on anybody who cuts the old growth for timber. Now into a little biodynamic. Now we look at the tree, how it grows. Trees are dynamic structures. I've already said this. They add material to support themselves in the environment, adding thickness and strength. So you don't always have to have a big tree ring for the tree to be adding a lot of strength. Some species will add a big ring on the compression side, conifers, but many deciduous trees are adding a pretty normal looking ring on the tension side with a lot of strength. So when you look at a tree, what it's trying to do, to give it a little personhood, is to add material throughout the whole structure to even out the stresses and strains. So to have to neutralize any hot spots where large loads or large stresses and strains might occur. The axiom of uniform stress. This is why trees are not shaped uniformly. And they're kind of like human engineers. They overdo it a bit. So with trees, it's assumed that they're over-engineering themselves by a factor of 1.5 to 2. So the tree builds enough structure that it has more than it needs so that when huge events, anomalous weather, another tree falling on the other tree, whatever comes along, it has that extra beef to keep itself going. You should be thinking about how fast the tree is growing in order that you build your structure with plenty of room so you don't have to start rebuilding it the very next year as a tree, you know, squeezing things or outgrowing you. When you add a heavy load, amount of growth right around the pin may increase radically. So there's several types of wood in trees. There's diffuse porous, ring porous wood, and conifer wood. And they're very subtly different and they're very grossly different. It's diffuse porous. If you look at the rings with a microscope or even with the naked eye, you'll see that the vessels are pretty uniform all the way across. So ring porous wood, the one that most people recognize is oak. Black locust is another wonderful ring porous wood. We prize them for their grain because the vessels are large in spring, and as the wood ring grows during the year, the increment grows during the year, the vessels get smaller. Usually you can see the rings pretty well in that type of tree. So the conifer wood definitely differs. It has these things called parenchyma, the ray parenchyma, and they are the cell walls of tracheids, which are found only in conifer woods. So they're transport vessels and also mechanical support. So if you've ever cut a conifer, a pine, and seen drops of sap come out of the fresh edge of the cut after your chainsaw, those sap, that's coming out of tracheids. Those are the vessels where sap flows. The wood, the lignin portion of the wood is stiff, like cement, okay, in a cement structure. And the cellulose, the hose pipes that Stoopsy is showing you there, they're like the rebar in a steel and concrete structure, which you should know provides flexibility. Okay? Decay. That is an old pruning cut. that decayed, a bad cut, and then another decay column in the center of the tree, and the two were connected by the re-injury of the tree. So in treehouse building, all the old trees have decay. If you penetrate the tree in certain ways, you can expect to increase the ability of the decay to move through the tree, increase the ability of a decay that's growing up in the tree and one here to meet or coalesce. I can talk all day and all night about trees and still be happy. But what do you see here, guys?
Set of keys.
Oh yeah, what else? What other artifact do you see there?
A branch.
The branch what?
That was cut off and the tree
enveloped. Yeah, and that straight line there, okay? So there are very few straight lines in nature. And the thing I'm gonna leave you with is questioning things. You've gotta keep questioning things. And that's what we gotta do in the world, is shift paradigms forward. Remember, there are no straight lines in nature. And although this was a nicely made cut, and the tree did what? Sealed it over, didn't heal. And now, next year maybe, it's gonna have a complete ring around the whole tree again, where there was essentially a hole where the branch came out. Now, I would say that in treehouse business and in zip lines and courses where you want to bring people in the natural world, I don't care if you make proper cuts. In fact, I'd rather see you prune the tree in a non-defensive manner where all the cuts look like broken branches. Because it's pretty clear that trees do better with natural breaks than they do with pruning cuts. And there is a reason for making the proper cut, and I can go into that in another session. But questioning these things really makes sense. And so we are questioning these things, and I would submit that if you're building a treehouse and you can have very bad things happen if you have a very well-qualified arborist who means well, who comes to prune the tree, because he will or she will cut every dead branch off the tree with a saw and turn your beautiful natural tree into an artifact. And frankly, all tree pruning is for people, not for trees. They really don't need any help from us. There is no activity that we undertake on trees that's really for them. They are all anthropocentric in nature. They're for us. So when you prune out for somebody who wants to come and enjoy the natural tree, if you take away all the dead branches, guess what critter doesn't like the tree anymore? Birds. Okay? Birds love the dead branches. If you make these artifacts, those beautiful stubs with the moss and lichen are gone. And I've seen a magnificent 400-year-old tree so altered by somebody who, meaning well, pruned the tree, and Ken Huck shed tears. And another guy would have just killed that arborist. And Ken is too kind. So think about it. It's changing. It's an ecocentric approach. And I really think that an ecocentric approach with people manipulating things is probably our best hope for the planet right now. Thanks for listening.
Okay,
questions?
I see that. I think I don't know if I mentioned.